For those of you I've yet had the pleasure of meeting, my name is Lube. I'm an archaeologist working at Västerbottens County Museum, and my presentation today is titled Archaeological Archives, the Issue of Storage, Space, and Curation. The first archives, in an archaeological sense, might be that of the curiosity cabinets compiled by the early antiquarians during the Renaissance. These were products perhaps less to preserve, but more to inspire awe for and the study of curious items and wonderful books. This would over time, as archaeology began to develop as a field in the 19th century, to transform into archives meant to preserve as well as to produce a collection of cultural and scientific value. Driven by national museums and local historical societies, items were collected and received as gifts, forming collections of growing sizes. These collections were later organized practically to what we are familiar with today in bookshelves, drawers, and boxes. Of course, a museum also acts as an archive for excavations that produce information contained in various formats, such as maps, photos, drawings, items, samples, and other types of documents. A digital archive strives to achieve the same function as its predecessor, to store and make information readily accessible over the long term. The main difference is that the archive data is electronic in nature. It provides the means of retaining and organizing digitally produced materials in collections of photos, videos, audio recordings, and other various formats. Of course, the digitalized analog archives inhabit this space as well. No matter the scale of the operation, from the individual's personal computer to an international database, the data may be stored in similar ways. Different digital archives may contain a variety of things or specialized towards, for example, historical maps that require large storage space on their servers where these digital maps are kept. The physical space has been transformed into a question of gigabytes, or as of today, terabytes. Archaeologists' source material remains in the field, where excavations and surveys unearth new sites and objects to analyze. Documentation continues largely the same, with photos, maps, and drawings of profiles remaining a necessity. Although the limitations of a camera with a 32 photo roll has since long been replaced by that of a digital camera at the price of quantity. Newer methods using drones for aerial photography allow us to see further and study features difficult to see from the ground, whilst also providing an avenue for 3D models to be produced. The amount of material produced for documentation has increased significantly. Likewise, the time to organize, curate, and store this digital material of shapefiles and photos has also increased. Other new methods entering the laboratories is near-infrared spectroscopy and XRF that are being used to study the prominence of raw materials in artifacts. This is useful when determining what kind of copper alloy is being observed or whether a stone tool was produced from the same materials found in a region, or if it's only visually the same, but chemically different. These new methods provide a variety of new formats and demand a considerable amount of space and are complex to store. Most data being produced digitally are stored first at the individual's computer. Here at our office desks, an overwhelming amount of data is being organized in lists and folders to prepare them and the finds that are temporarily filling our bookshelves to be sorted. A curation process ensues to determine what should be saved at a local server and archive and what should be passed on and be published and stored at the regional archive. This needs to be done due to the sheer amount of data being produced. A single product can result in hundreds of photos, shapefiles, and documents in varying formats. And when newer methods like photogrammetry is being applied to make documentation of the field faster, it inherently results in hundreds of photos in need of storage. Most of these may end up at the local server, providing the institution with a findable and accessible database of sorts containing project data and all files produced, as well as the smaller curated segments. These local servers can prove to be flexible and adapt to the needs of the department. However, some drawbacks of local digital archives are that they are expensive, and the department must spend considerable resources and time to maintain and upgrade both hardware and software, as well as provide backup systems for their digital archives. A local server isn't terribly accessible either, unless you can visit it in person. The obstacle with the use of data collected by others, long ago or recently, is ever-present in its dispersed state. The need for findable, accessible, and reusable data has driven the creation of publicly available databases. These databases draw upon these collections and analysis results to provide a platform for a digital archive. Databases such as the Strategic Environmental Archaeology Database is closely cooperating with the laboratories who produce the initial data and is thus an archive for laboratory reports and results. Neotoma is another database following a similar vein and is currently in the process of incorporating what used to be the European Pollen Database. Flexible archives meant more for searching in terms, semantic networks, and regional specific developments are Ariadne and DataArc. The digital archives suffer from just the same obstacles as classical archives, the lack of space. However, it is not as tangible as confronting a room filled with boxes. As methods become more advanced, the results tend to demand more space to accommodate for this increase in precision and accuracy in the data. More formats and digital documentation usually result in an abundance of material that needs to be curated for a report and later a wider selection to be placed in archives. But what of the remaining photos, maps, models, and shapefiles? And moreover, who is responsible for curating, converting, and quality assuring the archives when new systems and new formats are developed and adopted? Especially so when it occurs at the hands of a government agency or database. Whose responsibility is it to store and update data long term? These questions may seem clear. However, the responsibility of who will be managing such large quantities of data is sometimes a gray zone. The time, funding, and storage needed to organize and then digitalize records is immense. These expenses may, over time, result in the termination of a project or cuts in funding that may result in the slow decline of a database. It has occurred many times that databases close down due to the lack of funding. And should no other entity exist to incorporate their data, it may result in a partial or total loss of gray data. Likewise, the maintenance and administration of digital archives is a time-consuming process in need of specialists who can consult those who produce the source data to best manage the data and metadata. Of course, this only briefly touches upon the issues of storage and how a seemingly closed and curated project again must be handled by the institutions. Thank you for your time. I appreciate the opportunity to speak for you today.